good afternoon, technically afternoon, and welcome or welcome back to the pop-up exhibition series of the NACAS. Every week we invite a distinguished speaker from campus, the community, and we invite out of our collection storage one or more objects to join us so that our community can enjoy them with us, and on top of what's already on display, and invite you to stay on later and visit the exhibitions and see what's on display. But the idea is to really bring objects out so that they can, they're sometimes shielded behind them with a little plexiglass, but to sort of have some sense of closeness, of proximity with the objects in the NACAS collection. 15,000 objects from all over the world. So one today, the topic, and I'll introduce the speaker in a second, the topic has to do also with furniture. So we brought out some storage, a piece of furniture, Syria 1920s, a great political statement, putting the Magen David, the six-pointed stars on top of it, the lamp with Arabic inscriptions as a way to really signal the emergence of the Zionist movement in the close diaspora, in the area of Syria, Palestine, in the early 20th century. So every week we try to find the connection between ideas that are circulating and percolating around our community and projects and what we do here every day. It's really a delight to have Rachel Guillot at the Magnus. It's finally, what can I say, soft. Rachel needs no introduction in the Bay Area, but she's an author, a scholar, an educator, a therapist, many different things. Her research and book on women and Jewish law remains is a staple of many families and scholars' bookshelves, and it continues to be studied and used as an important reference. She's currently working on a novel, and I'm sure we'll hear about that, but I think it's Lost and Found. Well, we'll see. Lost and Found, it's a novel that is about family origins and sort of fragments of narrative, and in a way that's what we do here every day. Collect and connect fragments in narrative ways through research and exhibitions. So please join me in welcoming Rachel Guillot to the Magnus, to the pop-up exhibition series, for a talk on sex and furniture and church tradition.
So yes, it is wonderful to be here and to talk about this subject. I tell you, part of the reason that it's called sex, there will be furniture in every text and in every sexual questions we'll address, but I came...
You got interrupted right away. Microphone. Yeah. Okay.
I came around to doing this topic because I thought for many years about sex in Jewish tradition. And after 15 years, people like that, been there, done that, you know. So then I wanted to kind of liven it up. And I looked at the texts that I was typically teaching, and lo and behold, suddenly you look at it from a different point of view, and the furniture just keeps popping up. So really, to tell you the truth, I wanted the bed in here. But they don't have an ancient bed. And what's wonderful about this lamp, and we will have a lamp too, so furniture and furnishings, is that this to me is also kind of suggestive of a canopy bed. So use your imagination, and actually now I'm going to turn this off so it doesn't get in the way of seeing the slides. So you should all be holding a piece of paper, but I don't see that that's happening. So you will all be holding a piece of paper, and we're going to read just a handful of interesting, juicy, and emblematic texts that reflect attitude towards sexuality in the rabbinic period. So when I talk about the rabbinic period, I'm talking about roughly the Mishnah and the Talmud, so roughly, very roughly, from about the first century before the Common Era to the fourth, fifth century. And I'm not going to get into detailed analysis of how early is this text and how does it relate to another text, because really what I want us to take from this is a sense of what the formative texts create as a kind of a structure or attitudes to sexuality, which we then see playing out throughout Jewish law and Jewish behavior, Of course, there's always a gap, sometimes huge, between what's written in the halakha in Jewish law and what's being done in the bedroom. And we'll actually read a text that's important in terms of sort of creating permission for a lot more happening in the bedroom than what would seem to be mandated by the texts. So, let's go to the first image, since we don't have the text yet. Okay, so we're going to start with the text about the bed, and I thought, what actually did the beds look like? Because the Mishnah and Talmud is full of references to beds. But, and lo and behold, we have an actual bed from Pompeii. So obviously the mattress and the bedding disintegrated when the lava came through, but the structure of the bed, I think we could sell it at the Brooklyn Design Store, right? Wood platform. Anyway, so that's from Pompeii, from Herculaneum, next to Pompeii. And this is just a bigger one of the one on the cover so that you can see what people would be doing in those beds. And this bed is pretty much the exact same structure with an extra, a few extra pillars because it wasn't just for sleeping, so it needed more support. And this is from the area of Pompeii where they had the whorehouses. And in front of each, I don't know if in front of each room, but in many of them there were pictures of what kind of services you could get in that room. Is there a page of texts for me?
Yeah.
Okay. So, one more picture of the bed and then we'll go to the first text. And remember this also for later in terms of non-missionary positions. This bed I like because look at the legs. I love them, and maybe they'll feature later. Okay, so we're going to start with the first text, which is from Brachot, from the tractate of the Talmud that discusses blessings. And the text is important because blessings are very much tied to the exact nature of the activity you're involved in, so you have to know exactly what it is that you're doing. In order to say that recite the correct blessing, you need to be educated as to what's happening in front of your eyes. So in terms of food, for example, you have to know whether this food that you're eating is from a tree or from or a vegetable from the earth, or is it grapes, etc. There are different blessings. So Rav Kahana lay under the bed of Rav Shmaya, who was carousing and speaking frivolously with his wife of sexual matters. Speaking frivolously is basically beriba. Afterwards, Shmaya had intercourse with her. Rav Kahana said to Rav Shmaya, you appear, they don't tell you exactly when, but presumably at the end of intercourse, you appear to me like a hungry man who has never had sex before, for you act with frivolity in your lust. He, Shmaya that is, said to Kahana, are you here? Get out! It's not proper for you, it is improper for you to lie under my bed. Kahana said to him, this is a matter of Torah, and I must study. So, this is funny, and somebody has written a book about humor in the Talmud. There are other passages like this that are ridiculous, and I'm personally quite certain that they had a sense of humor. Nevertheless, the point here is that every act, biological, physiological, is regulated in Jewish law. How you eat, how you go to the bathroom, how you have sex, this is all regulated by Jewish law, and therefore we say, this is Torah, and I have to study, which is kind of important as a foundation stone to understand why it is that the rabbis spend so much time, and they do, discussing sexual matters. They discuss when, where, how often, what should you do in the room? So you're supposed to darken the room. There's a story about one rabbi who was so fastidious about not being distracted by anything that he would kill all the flies first. And I'll tell you, in the Middle East, there's a lot of flies. So it wasn't just one. What you should be thinking about, what you should talk to your wife about, because the rabbis have decided that the woman needs to be aroused, because the optimal act of intercourse is the one where the woman has an orgasm first. and then because that will promote having male children. So the rabbis are interested in promoting female orgasm, which is kind of surprising. I was surprised when I first came across that. And therefore, they engage in discussion of what the husband should do to promote this, both in terms of what kind of stuff he should talk about. So he should talk about sexual matters to turn her on, but he should also talk about exemplary students of the law who were the result of such exemplary unions. And this then evolves in the Middle Ages, in the 13th century, there is a whole tract, a whole treatise called the Holy Book, the Holy Letter, Igeret HaKodesh, which is traditionally attributed to Nachmanides, who is one of the most important Spanish biblical commentators. It wasn't written by him, but the fact that it was attributed to him means that whoever wrote it felt that they could pass it as written by one of the great scholars of the generation, and it's a sex manual. And it starts out, chapter one, what you do the evening before, when you should eat your dinner, what you shouldn't eat, because it doesn't promote delicate body functions, etc., etc., all the way to chapter eight, which actually describes the sexual act and goes through explaining to the husband what to do so that his wife is aroused and so that she has an orgasm. And then another sort of sidebar about what are all the bad things you could do in terms of thinking about other women, being distracted by sounds of other people passing outside your house, which is why you should do it after midnight, etc., etc. And it's a whole actual sex manual that continues to be in circulation in the Orthodox Jewish world. So this lays the foundation for the rabbis feeling very comfortable discussing technical matters of sex. And of course, the other thing they're very interested in is slicing precisely the distinction between sexual pleasure and promoting procreation, because they're of course very pro-procreation. But they make a very clear distinction already in the Mishnah based on biblical passages between sexual pleasure and procreation. And sexual pleasure is only really important for the rabbis in terms of a woman's sexual pleasure, which is referred to as onah. Really, more precisely, a woman's sexual right, a woman's right to have sexual pleasure from her husband. And the obligations of onah are designated in the Mishnah very precisely. It says, depending on your profession, it says, students of the law, in other words, the rabbis are talking about themselves, must initiate sex once a week. Because many of them actually are studying away from home during the week. And then it goes to the other professions. Peddlers who have a donkey and go from around town twice a week. People who are independently wealthy every day. Camel drivers once in 3 months, in 30 days. Well, that's apropos of the camel too. Because they go on long voyages. So, you know, there will be a conflict between their sexual obligations and their profession. And sailors, and I hope nobody here is a Navy spouse, every 6 months. And then they hasten to add that this is how often a man has to offer his wife sexual relations. She doesn't have to accept. So she can say, and I'm literally, I have headache. And so basically the idea is that they also recognize that there is such a thing as rape in marriage, and they forbid it. So the husband's obligation is to offer and to see what his wife is in the mood for and then perform. And of course that's with the additional element that the laws of menstruation and purity require that the woman not have sex and in fact not touch her husband during the period of her menstruation and then 7 more days. So when you think about it, you say, oh, okay, well that's 11 to 14 days every month. However, in ancient society, and really until modern times, women menstruated very infrequently during the fertile years. They were either pregnant or nursing. So the idea that this was like a very limited window is actually a modern construction. And in fact, in the rabbinic period, women were available for sexual relations very often. Okay, I have a lot more to say, but let's move on because we've got to talk about furniture. So So this is from the Babylonian Talmud. Rabbi Yochanan ben Da'avai said, the ministering angels, Malachi Asharet, these are the Jews in the Mishnah in the British time, had a whole angelology, which was kind of an optional as to whether you wanted to believe it or not. But they liked talking about it. It was kind of fun. So the ministering angels told me four things. People are born lame because their parents overturned the table. Okay, that's the furniture. Overturned the table. Dumb because they kiss that place. In other words, the female genitalia. Deaf because they converse during intercourse. Blind because they look at that place. So right away we see that there's a contradiction between this text and the previous text. Because in the previous text, this great rabbi is talking all the time in order to arouse his wife. So we won't get into that contradiction because it's resolved by what comes next. Rabbi Yochanan said, the above is the opinion of Rabbi Yochanan ben Da'avai, but our sages said, so this is the majority opinion. You know, the Talmud is, in the Mishnah and the Talmud are structured around bringing together opposing opinions. Sometimes this school versus that school, but very often so-and-so says this, but the rest of us say that. And the minority opinions are very important ways of shedding light on what the cultural conflict was. So Rabbi Yochanan says that's his opinion. He's out there in left field. The sages, the majority opinion said, the halakha is not, as Rabbi Yochanan ben Da'avai, but rather a man may do whatever he pleases with his wife. Okay? So it's an open arena. A woman once came before Rabbi, this is Rabbi Judah, the prime patriarch of Yudan Sea, who is attributed with creating the huge cultural enterprise of editing the Mishnah. And says to him, so again, she's going to the numero uno of the rabbis of her period, and she says, Rabbi, I have set a table for my husband, but he has overturned it. Rabbi replied, my daughter, the Torah has permitted you to him, what then can I do for you? So let me elucidate that a little bit. Usually I would have people figure it out themselves, but we don't have time. But let's look, while we're thinking about what that means, let's look at a few tables and see what this business about turning the table is. So this is a mosaic from Tzipori, which is in the gallery, which is right where they were editing the Mishnah. So I thought, you know, let's talk about something that was happening a little later. This is in Tzipori, if any of you have been to Israel or going back, the excavations, the mosaics are spectacular. And they were Roman-style villas that the wealthy Jews built for themselves. And this is just a little side detail. And what I love about it is that chair could be from Scandinavian design. And the table, but this artist was a little unclear on the legs. He didn't know how to do the legs in proportion. So he said, okay, we don't need the legs. We know what it is. But then here is a fresco from Rome that shows us a very solid table with two very nice legs, and presumably on the side that's hidden from the picture, there's two other legs. So think about this table. The Romans were also very fond of triangular tables, tripods. I think mainly because they're much easier to balance. If any of you have ever done carpentry, four legs is a nightmare. Three works very well. This one is bronze from Pompeii. And here's a mosaic that shows you this tripod in use. I don't know what this guy is saying, but I don't think it's about sex. Apparently four legs, because there's another one, you see, and there's another one. And I think that's it for the tables. Oh, here's some more tables, which shows you actually dining tables, because maybe, you know, food and sex are closely related. Dining tables with sort of couches at a festive meal, a symposium. And since Passover is not that far off, I thought I would show this is what we mean by Mesubim. This is how the wealthy Roman ate. They crouched, they reclined on couches around tables, and here's another tripod table. And back in Tzipori, around the banquet hall, there's a spectacular mosaic that was essentially the carpet, and around it were the benches, the sort of sofas that people reclined in. And if you go back there, or if you go there for a certain time, you notice that there's actually an L shape in mosaic that shows you where to put the couch so that you would get the best view. Anyway, so that those are various tables. So whether you're talking about a tripod or a four-legged table, what does it mean to turn the table? So actually, the rabbis leave it ambiguous. They use this term, turning the table, la'afoch et ha'shulchan, several times, to refer to unconventional sexual positions. And the later commentaries have a field day, because, you know, it's a technical question, they have to discuss it, I think they're kind of enjoying it, as to whether that means that the woman is the top, which would mean that the woman is sort of the table, kind of in the image that you have to think about, and she's supposed to be upside down, but then it's turned upside down. That's one positive option. The other hard option is that it's actually anal intercourse, and it's the turning of the table in that sense. But that doesn't exactly work either, but it doesn't matter. They didn't really bother with the geometric possibilities. The point is that it's a non-missionary position. And what this text shows us is that they had all kinds of ideas about what you could do during sex that is not the missionary position, just, you know, have intercourse as fast as possible for the purpose of procreation and go to sleep. And basically, there is some sentiment against that. In other words, Yochanan ben Davai says that angels told me this. So he attributes it to a higher power. But the majority says angels, shmangels, we don't listen to angels. The halakha, the law is, you can do whatever you want in bed. And what's interesting about the actual text case that they bring in, it seems that the woman is very uncomfortable with it. But we don't know if she's uncomfortable because she doesn't like this sexual position, because she's not educated in the halakha. She doesn't know if this is allowed. So she goes to the rabbi to say, I'm set the table, in other words, I prepared myself in the proper position, and my husband turned it upside down, and he says, what can I do? This is permitted. And if we were to be able to exhume this woman and ask her, it would be interesting, or to write the feminist midrash, one way to explain is to say she actually doesn't like it. She's looking to the rabbi to tell him that he can't do that, maybe. Or maybe she does like it, but she wants to be sure that she is not participating in a transgression. And he says to her, there's nothing I can do. And he kind of is not that happy about it either, right? Because he's not saying, oh, it's all wonderful, just go off and do whatever you want. He said, it's permitted in the Torah, there's nothing I can do to help you. Okay, moving along. So now we've done two beds. No, we've done a bed and a table. Now I want to go back to the triangular table for a minute, so you can take a quick look at it. That triangular table, and that's maybe the next text. It's a fairly obscure text. So this is from the commentary on Exodus. So it's not a halakhic text, it's more of a midrashic text that weaves a lot of interpretations and stories around the biblical text, and it emerges to begin with at the same time as the Mishnah and the Talmud, but then it's a much longer process of sort of accruing texts that get included in what's called the Midrash Rabbah. So this is the book of Exodus. So the structure is always, there's a biblical passage and then an explanation of that passage. The biblical passage is, Moses says to God, why does your wrath wax hot against your people? This is after one of God's outbursts. This can be compared to a royal dignitary who, on entering his house, discovered his wife embracing the Delphic, whatever that means, we don't know what it means. The Delphic or the Delphic, I don't know how to pronounce it even, and he became angry. Whereupon his friend said to him, if it could give birth, this Delphic, in other words, if it had power, and had sexual power more specifically, you would have every right to be angry. But he's saying to him, but it's a piece of furniture, so what do you care if your wife is embracing actually the Hebrew word is megapephet, which means to sort of rub herself against it. Very sensual. He said, to which he, so then the wealthy man says, replied, I know that it has no power whatsoever, but this is in order to teach her not to act in this way, because it's cut and rude and sexual and sensual outside of the context of heterosexual intercourse with her husband. And there's a very similar sentiment in the one passage that refers to lesbian act, sexual acts, which is women who are referred to as mesolenot, which is a very obscure word. We don't exactly know what it means. It means something like to rub body against body. And there's no, and the rabbis in the short discussion which said, well, there's no sexual act, because their definition of a sexual act is heterosexual intercourse. And homosexual intercourse also. But, you know, the penis has to be involved. So if two women are engaged in sexual arousal, there's no sexual act, so they say it's not a transgression. There's no impact on her status. Maimonides, in the 12th century, doesn't like that. And he says, yes, there's no sexual act and there's no transgression, but nevertheless, a man whose wife does this should not let her out of the house, and not let her invite any of those girlfriends of hers, because it's not proper. But he actually doesn't have any halakhic basis for it. So anyway, this woman is using this either... Okay, so what is this Delphic? So another text, perhaps tell us what it is. And Andreas, which is something else, which is like a little cupboard. And Andreas made for the sake of holding cups and bowls, is susceptible to impurity, since it is like a Delphic. So it's a piece of furniture. They have a similar status, meaning it's a piece of furniture that's used to put something on. So some of the commentators thought that it was probably a tripod like this that was used to put a statue on. The statue may be, one commentator says, may have been a dolphin, which was the Greeks, this would be Greek influence, the Greeks like dolphins and they had a sexual kind of association, or maybe some other sculpture of some sort that Jews weren't supposed to have in their homes but did, especially the wealthy. And so she was either rubbing herself against this pedestal table, or possibly there was a little sculpture, my imagination is wilder, there was a little sculpture of Eros on it, and she was doing what Eros is supposed to be there for. By the way, another version of this in the Midrash or Numbers says eunuch rather than Delphic, so that would make more sense. But that, I think, is a later text in order to explain this bizarre, because they all knew about all of these other texts. Anyway, so here, so now we are at tables and pedestals, and now we're going to pivot towards lamps. And this is another text that has, tells us a little bit about intimate family life in the missionary period. So this is a typical candle lamp that was used in ancient, the ancient Near East, ancient Palestine. There's a gazillion of them. You can buy many supposedly authentic ones, many fakes. This one is from the Israel Museum, so I assume it's authentic. And you can see that it's darkened from, because the wick would come out of, you pour the oil in the big hole, and the wick comes out of the small hole, and you can see that there's signs of burning. It also can be seen as a very sexual image, but I'm not going to get into the Jungian thing. Okay, so now lamps and sex. So this is from the Jerusalem Talmud, which is a parallel Talmud to the Babylonian Talmud, which is our main canonic Talmud, but the Jerusalem Talmud is very important too. It was created and collected and codified in Palestine, while the Babylonian Talmud was codified in Iraq of the day. Rabbi Zacharia, the son-in-law of Rabbi Levi, would tell this story. Rabbi Meir used to give a regular discourse in the synagogue of Hamat in Tiberias, the hot spring in Tiberias, every Shabbat evening. So I don't know if it was like this discourse, but it was the drash for the weekend. And just in case you think, well, Who knows where that Hamad is? What do we have? Maybe some of you have seen it. So I have three images from the mosaic floor in this synagogue that they're talking about, that's been excavated in Tiberias, right near where the hot springs are. So this is a zodiac. This is the Ahavon HaKodesh with two candelabras, and I have a close-up of this Ahavon HaKodesh because that's really also inspired by the kind of wardrobes that they have. This is right in the zodiac. This is Helios. This is in the synagogue. Okay? So the whole idea the Jews didn't allow images and, you know, fought against assimilation to Hellenistic culture. And I'm seeing Eric, I shouldn't probably be saying it because it's probably wrong, but anyway, the unlearned version is that Jews very much participated in Hellenistic culture and had no, some of them at least, had no problem integrating Hellenistic images right into the middle of the synagogue. Bet Arfa is also a zodiac, which the Jews adopted from the surrounding culture. So that's Helios, and that's the Ahavon HaKodesh, and you can see that this may be based on the kind of wardrobe where they would keep cups and bowls and other valuables in a very wealthy home. This is a curtain that you could draw like this, and I think that's it. Okay, so this is where this happened, right there, a little earlier. But, okay, so, so this is interesting. So the Rabbi Meir gives a weekly drush every Friday night. A certain woman of the town made it the habit to listen to his weekly discourses. So that's really interesting in terms of the participation of women in religious life. But we don't have time to talk about it because we're talking about sex. But this woman, without her husband, goes every week, Friday night, which by the way, according to the rabbis, that's the night you're supposed to have sex. That is the prime night for sex, Friday night. Erev Shabbat, the beginning of the Sabbath. It elevates it into a holy act. So she goes to hear the lecture. On one occasion, where he, in other words, Rabbi Meir, extended it to a late hour, she waited and didn't leave until he finished. When she came home, she found that the lamp was out. Now, if this is not a double entendre, then I don't know what it is. The lamp was out. Her husband asked her, "Where have you been until now?" She told him, "I've been listening to the lecture's discourse." Now, the husband was a scoffer, like a riffraff. So he said to her, so he didn't appreciate that she was listening to the great rabbi's lecture instead of coming home to have sex. And maybe also to put the dinner on the table. "I swear by such and such that if you're not to enter my house again until you spit in the lecturer's face." She left the house and stayed away 1 week, a second, and a third. Finally, the neighbors asked her, "Are you still angry with each other? Let us go with you to the lecture to Rabbi Meir." And it explains, I have time to tell you how they resolve. So it's a terrible dilemma because she certainly can't go and spit in the great rabbi's face. Her husband is meanwhile has made a vow, it's a serious thing, so she can't go back home. The husband is thereby violating his obligation to have regular sexual relations with him. She is violating her non-legal but expected duty as a wife because she's not home. And the neighbors are getting worried because, you know, the neighbors are in your business all the time, like everywhere. So she said, "Well, what am I going to do?" to her girlfriend. "I can't go and spit in his face." Rabbi Meir sometimes hears this rumor, and he pretends that he has some kind of an eye ailment. And he says, "I know that the way to cure this ailment is for somebody to spit into my eye 7 times. Is there any woman here, because women are known for knowing this kind of medical, popular folk medicine, do you guys in this neighborhood have any women who know how to do these sort of magical medical procedures and how to spit?" And the girlfriend said, "Go, you know?" So she said, "Okay, I'll go." So she goes and she comes in front of him and she breaks down. She says, "I'm sorry, I don't know nothing about spinning in medical procedures, and you know, I just came here because I'm in this terrible bind. And he says, no, 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 no. I know that you could do it. And he says, here, spit right in this eye 7 times. And she does. And he sends her home and he says, tell your husband, that no good Nick, that you spat in my face 7 times. She goes home, that's evidently all settles. And the students of Rabbi Meir says, are you nuts? You're letting a lowly woman spit into your face? How? You're debasing the glory of the Torah because you're a great learned man. And he says, I'd rather have the Torah debased for the sake of Shalom Bayit, of marital harmony. That's more important than the honor, than my honor. And the honor of the Torah is amplified through creating, resolving this situation and creating marital harmony. All of that in order to talk about the language. So finally, the one last bit, of, you remember the bit? So this is from the Midrash of Shir HaShirim, on the Song of Songs, which does have some stuff about love and stuff like that, because that's what the text is about. So this is an explanation for the verse, Nagila v'nismecha ba'ach, that we will be glad and rejoice in thee. We have learned elsewhere, so this is somebody quoting another story that appeared, you heard. If a man has married, no, this is whoever is telling us, we don't know, is quoting a well-known halakha, a well-known law. We have learned elsewhere that if a man has married a wife and lived with her 10 years, and she has not born him a child, he is not at liberty to neglect the duty of procreation, of begetting children. So a very small sidebar, according to Jewish law, men are obligated to procreate. Women are not. As we all know, women are essential to the operation. But women are doing it out of their own free will and wish, whereas men have to be ordered by the force of law to do this, because otherwise they make all kinds of other arrangements of things they could do. And that obligation to procreate includes the obligation to raise and support the children. And the important thing about the fact that, which we won't get into today, the fact that women are exempt is that it opens a window of possibilities for contraception. There are certain circumstances where women may, or according to some opinions, even must use contraception in order to avoid conception if it's going to pose a danger to themselves or to an existing child. But we won't go into that. So, basically, according to halakha, if a man is married 10 years and he hasn't fathered any children, he has to do something about it. So he has to either take a second wife or divorce his wife and marry another woman who is going to be fertile. There's, by the way, a lot of discussion of infertility because the rabbis are aware that sometimes it's because the woman is not fertile and sometimes it's because the man, as they say, doesn't shoot like an arrow. But we won't get into that. Rabbi Edie said, it happened once that a woman in Sidon, which is in Lebanon, had lived for 10 years with her husband without bearing him a child. They came to Rabbi Shimon ben Yochai, again one of the great rabbis of his generation, and requested to be parted from one another. He said to them, I adjure you, just as you've always shared a festive board together, we saw those tables with all that nice food, do not part save with festivity. In other words, put on a big party to demonstrate to the world that you are parting out of necessity, not out of because you don't love each other anymore, not because this was not a happy marriage, but your hands are tied, so to speak. They made a great feast and drank very freely. The feeling, drinking freely is important. Feeling that they presumably invited all their friends in the neighborhood. Feeling then in a good humor, he, the husband, said to her, my daughter, which is a very common term of endearment. It's not to be understood as infantilizing her. It's a very common term of endearment for a wife. My daughter, pick out any article you want in my house and take it with you to your father's house. In other words, she's going to be divorced and go back to her father's house. What did she do? When he was asleep, she gave an order to her servants and handmaids to lift him up on the bed. That's why I wanted to show you those really strong carved legs. Lift him up on the bed and take and carry him asleep on the bed, because he had drunk a lot, to her father's house. At midnight he awoke from his sleep, and when the effects of the wine passed from him, he said, "My daughter, where am I?" She replied, "You are in my father's house." You're in your father's, whoops, what happened to this line? "Oh, and what am I doing in your father's house?" he said. She replied, "Did you not say it to me last night? Take any article you like from my house to go to your father's house. There is nothing in the world I care for more than you." They again went to Rabbi Shimon ben Yochai, so presumably they told him the whole story. He went and prayed for them, and they became fertile. So this is like a classic happy end fairy tale story in the Midrash, of which there are some kind of romantic, wonderful stories. There are wonderful romantic stories about Rabbi Akiva and his wife, and indicates that even though the halakha is that you have to separate after 10 years, the rabbis really were not interested in breaking up happy marriages. And later on, as the halakha evolved, they basically said, yes, this is the halakha. So if a man wants to divorce his wife, obviously he's entitled to, but if he doesn't want to, we don't compel him. The community, the rabbis don't intervene and force a divorce, and they say, this is later on I think it's in the Shulchan Aruch, so this is going much, much later, but it says what we do is that family takes care of orphans and pays the dowry of orphan girls so that they can marry. So we have 2 minutes for questions.
Of course, in modern times, in the ultra-Orthodox world, this is taken to a
an extreme in the sense that it's typical to have between 8 and 12 children. People who don't know that much about Jewish traditional society assume that this is how it always was. This is a completely modern phenomenon for two reasons. For maybe more than two. The first one is that back in the day, before modern times, before formula, women nursed for 2 years. That was the typical age, and that for most women works fairly effectively as a contraceptive. So the typical age between children was 2.5 to 3 years. In fact, in the Mishnah, there is a discussion of a nursing woman can use birth control in order not to get pregnant. And the rabbis say, why? And the answer is, well, because she might get pregnant. It's unusual, but she might get pregnant. And if she gets pregnant, the flavor of and the texture of the milk will change. Which I assume is true, because there's a whole big hormonal change. And she would have to wean the nursing baby prematurely. And from that text and other texts, it's clear that already in the rabbinic period and into basically the 19th century, the assumption was that you nurse for about 2 years and then you wean and then you get pregnant again. That's number one. And number two is medicine, you know, high public hygiene and modern medicine. So a lot fewer children were lost in childbirth and infancy. So if you look at, let's say, the memoirs of Glickle of Hamlin, which is one of the first person accounts we have of Glickle, who was a wealthy woman in Germany, she had 5 surviving children, and either 7 or 8 births, then I don't remember. But anyway, it was very common to lose 25 to 35% of your children and to only get pregnant every 2 to 3 years. So the average family that, if you look at memoirs, in you know the bastion of traditional Jewish society, whether it be in Eastern Europe or in Morocco or in Iraq, was 5 children. And this new phenomenon of, you know, 2-digit is a completely modern society phenomenon. And what's very common now in the ultra-Orthodox world is to nurse the baby for 8 months and then put him on a bottle. And if you already have 10, then you can see why you would do that, right? I don't have time to get into details, but the implications in terms of contraception, there's a very broad range of opinions, from fairly permissive opinions that say basically a woman may use contraception for any perceived threat to her well-being or the well-being of her children, to a much more restrictive that says you only use birth control if the life of the mother, if the life of the mother is in danger as a result of pregnancy, like ectopic pregnancy or very severe preeclampsia, there's no question, including in the most ultra-Orthodox rulings, but there's a very broad field in between. Okay, I know I'm supposed to end at 1, so, yeah, here. Was I wrong about the whole rabbit?
No, that's fine. I just want to pick up what Bluma said, because I'm intrigued by this passage too, Exodus Rabbah, because there is an answer, my God, not to the final question, but on the one hand, there is a concern by the husband. So what was it his wife was doing with this delicate hair, using it as a sex toy or something?
Right.
But God doesn't give a damn about that. That's the interesting thing. God said this is an idol.
Right.
I don't care what was he was doing with it that the husband was worried about that. And Moses, you would think, Moses is not experienced with idolatry by this time.
Right.
That's why it's a you've got two different things going on here.
Right.
It's the husband's concern, and one is God's concern. Completely different. Now, it does pick up on the Torah in terms of Moses always arguing.
Not right.
Again,
right.
So that's part of this
background. Right. Yes, but I think that the analogy, so the psychomythical analogy, is that sex is 95% in the head. So yes, there's no sexual transgression because it's either a pedestal or a table, or let's even say that it's a sculpture of Eros. or as even said that it's a eunuch, there's no sexual transgression because it's not a pope with man. But in her mind, it's as good as what she does with her husband. So the husband, so in that sense, it's similar to the idolatry. God knows perfectly well that those idols have no power, but in the mind of the people, they have the power. So I think that that's the analogy, that they both recognize that it's the psychological aspect, psycho-mythical aspect of idolatry or sex. It's the most powerful. It's not the mechanical, physical connection. It's what it means to you. I think Freud would have been very happy about that. Okay. I have to run out with my friend who's going back to my kibbutz as we speak, and then I'll come back if anybody wants to.
You can run and carry the Jewish world with you.
Oh my goodness.
Over your head. Thank you very, very much. Okay.